good evening. Welcome to our very first music department's charity concert. I'm really excited to share this type of event with you. As you can see, it's very encompassing of all of our groups, including some additional things back there that we'll talk about in a little bit. We've branded this performance event under Music Makes Moments slogan, with the idea that through music as our vehicle, we're all coming together between us the musicians and you as the parents and the friends and supporters and the people back there that are helping something to raise money for this amazing organization. We're all using music to come together to create those moments and help create more moments for the people that are affected by these diseases that we are going to keep supporting every year. So we're really excited you can be here for this. We're excited that students have been working really, really hard over the past couple weeks to put this program together. We're going to start off the evening with Mr. Lauer playing the national anthem. So if you would please rise, we'll start off.
Thank you. Club. I'd like to take this moment to welcome you all to the first annual Music Department Charity Concert, just like Ms. Drake said as well. I'm Jerry Lowry, Band Director of Department Charity here at Hoffman, and I'm greatly appreciative of your presence here. I'd first like to recognize some wonderful people here for whom this is all possible. That starts with my fantastic colleagues, Mr. Langridge, Ms. Drake, and Mr. Schlesinger. Also, the world's greatest accompanist, Miss Susan Chapel, back there. All right, this evening is a great time to celebrate the incredible impact music can have on our world and the importance of outreach to the fabric of our society. I personally hold this event very special to my heart. It shows that the power of this art form need not always be stated in our future plans and endeavors, but in the value of our present human experience. The creative process, the discipline, the critical thinking, sensitivity to aesthetics, along with our ability to reach out to the world for positive change, are shaping incredible human beings as we speak. So relax and enjoy some great music that our music department has united to put together for you and to support a fantastic cause. Our next act is the concert choir. They will be performing a lovely little piece called Hymns from the Rig Veda, Movements 1 and 2. The piece was one of the songs part of a four-group collection, Choral Hymns from the Rig Veda, by British composer Gustav Holst. All the pieces had English text translated from Sanskrit by the composer himself and put to music in the Western classical tradition of rarely performed these days. This is our concert choir.
Thank you. Antonin Dvorak is known as the Symphony from the New World. It's labeled as such because Dvorak, being from Bohemia, the Czech Republic, wrote this symphony while spending time in America. While in the States, Dvorak was influenced by folk music, specifically songs of the slaves in the South. This very popular work had an influence in turn on American composers as they worked to find an American sound. The Symphony Orchestra will now perform an abridged version of the great finale.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Our next act is a faculty act. A little bit about the piece. Johannes Brahms is one of the great composers of the 19th century and one of the major composers of Lieder, which is so. In Botschaft, the male singer sends a message to his lover through the wind. Brahms cleverly uses the piano accompaniment to paint the winds, unpredictable winds. In the end, the singer is overjoyed to know that she is thinking of him as well. Now, Mr. Schlesinger, Mrs. Chappell performing Brahms Overture.
I wanted to give you an idea how this sort of came about. So about a few months ago, I brought an idea to the kids and said, let's do a charity concert. They're like, okay, cool. Then we decided to try to figure out what that charity would represent. I just sent out a little application to the kids, and then several students came up with a presentation, a brief presentation. They wrote a little letter as to why they decided on their given charity. And so we presented them to each other, and then each group kind of voted. And so the vote itself came back, and Adele Shirky's presentation supporting the National Multiple Sclerosis Society with what came out on top. So that's what we decided, and that's why we have a representative here to speak a little later on in the show. But now I wanted to give you an opportunity to meet the person behind the idea and give you an idea, so she can give you sort of the background on why she chose National Multiple Sclerosis Society. So give a huge round of applause for our sophomore flutist, Adele Shirky.
Wonderful people for helping put together all of this. I want to start off by thanking the music department, which includes Ms. Drake, Mr. Langridge, Mr. Lowry, and Mr. Schlesinger for allowing all the student musicians and performers here to have opportunities such as this. I'd like to also thank Triumph for creating a great environment of leaders that took the initiative to put together all of this, including all the setting up and later on taking down as well as ushering. I'd like to thank the Music Parents Association for doing all the behind-the-scenes logistical work, because without them, I'm not sure if we've been able to put together all of this, including the trip to DC. I want to thank the students for supporting the music department and their decisions towards the future of the program. And finally, I'd like to thank every parent, friend, family member, teacher, student, guest, or anyone else in the audience for supporting not only the students, but being benevolent and kind towards myself and the charity chosen. Now, I'd like to talk about what we're here learning about today, which is MS, short for multiple sclerosis. And multiple sclerosis is a rare disease that causes a person's nervous system to practically eat away at itself. According to the Mayo Clinic, a nonprofit academic medical center and healthcare company, there are fewer than 200,000 cases per year. However, what does it mean to have MS? Turns out, it's different for each person who has it. Some common symptoms can include difficulty in speaking, poor balance, difficulty in walking, anxiety, mood swings, overall weakness, or even problems with coordination. Those who have MS unfortunately suffer from this disease without knowing of a current cure. There are several treatments such as self-care, therapy, medication, and specialist. But why are we all here today learning about this specific disease? In what relation does it have towards you and towards me? When I first saw this opportunity to share my support for a charity that can make a difference not only to our community but to others, the one person I thought of was my dad. His name is Paul Shirky, and he's defined by the disease he has. My memories of him, even at the young age of 6, do not include his early struggles with his disease. Instead, it was filled with his determination to be a good father. He could feel his legs giving away and the power he had left in his arms weakening, yet this never stopped him from walking me to my bus stop every morning, or from shoveling the streets of our neighborhood in the winter, or from teaching me how to ride my bike, or cooking dinner for my brother and I. He's managed to make a difference to me even in the toughest of days because he didn't let multiple sclerosis tell him he can't. Though at times like now, when a disease like MS has settled in for around a decade, it's easy to throw in the towel, yet he hasn't. So looking back at when I was given this opportunity, I chose an organization that was relatively big enough to make a difference. This obviously being NMSS, also known as the National Multiple Sclerosis Society. Their aspirations revolve around an MS-free world so that families of a loved one with MS won't have to worry about the symptoms of adversity. That's why today we are here learning about this disease that affects a few directly and many indirectly. And now on another note, I'd like to now introduce Shades of Blue singing Another Day of Sun from the award-winning film La La Land.
I think about that day. I left him at a greenhouse station.
The Arrival of the Queen of Sheba, a symphonia for two oboes and strings by George Friedrich Handel. It premiered in London in 1749 as first seen in the oratorio Solomon. This was one of Handel's last of his oratorios, and Solomon is rarely performed today in its entirety. But Handel's bright and lively The Arrival of the Queen of Sheba interlude is a widely appreciated processional set piece. It's often played during wedding ceremonies. And a noted public performance of the piece occurred during the opening ceremonies of the London 2012 Olympic Games. Tonight, you will hear a duet for flute and cello played by Ms. Drake and Mr. Lang.
And we just have one more piece break. Before that, I wanted to kind of bring somebody up to the microphone to give you an idea of where all these kind gestures are going to go. And she's a representative from the National Multiple Sclerosis Society, so please give a round of applause for Ms. Shannon Freedy.
Good evening. On behalf of the National Multiple Sclerosis Society, I would first like to take a moment to thank Lisa Walkery, Adele, for speaking earlier and sharing your story. That takes a lot of courage to get up here and share your story, so I appreciate that. And the rest of the students that are involved in the band or the music department, thank you so much for benefiting the MS Society tonight. So can we give them all a round? So multiple sclerosis is an unpredictable, often disabling disease of the central nervous system that disrupts the flow of information between the brain and the rest of the body. Symptoms of MS are very variable and they're unpredictable. No two people have the exact same symptoms, and MS, in each person's symptoms can change or fluctuate throughout their lifetime. While the disease is not contagious or directly inherited, scientists have identified factors in the distribution of MS around the world that may eventually help determine what causes MS. These factors include gender, genetics, age, and ethnic background. A recent study founded by the MS Society confirmed that nearly 1 million people in the United States are living with MS. There's 2.3 million worldwide. So it's pretty prevalent. This breakthrough is a pivotal moment in the MS movement, and its scientifically sound measures of prevalence helps us better understand the disease and its impact. With twice as many people living with MS, solutions for MS are now twice as important. The vision of the MS Society is a world free of MS. Everything we do is focused so that people affected by MS can live their best lives. As we stop MS in its tracks, restore what has been lost, and end MS forever. But we are more than an organization. We are a movement, united in the collective power to do something about MS now and end the disease forever. Tonight, the National MS, or with the support we receive tonight, that the National MS Society will continue to address the challenges each person affected with the disease experiences. To fulfill this mission, the Society funds cutting-edge research, drive change through advocacy, facilitates professional education, collaborates with MS organizations around the world, and provides programs and services designed to help people living with MS and their families move forward with their lives. We are dedicated to achieving a world free of MS and are grateful for the support we are receiving from Hoffman Estates High School tonight. Thank you.
So we're going to close out this performance with our symphonic winds, playing an arrangement of West Side Story.
Thank you. Thank you.